The United States hoping to kickstart talks on a Gaza ceasefire after the death of Hamas leader Yahya Sinwar. The Biden administration has worked unsuccessfully for months with Qatar and Egypt to reach a deal that would see Israel cease operations in Gaza in exchange for the release of hostages. The U.S. State Department says Sinwar had been the chief obstacle to reaching an end to the war.
It's a good day for the world. We got, I hope, these are now the congratulations of getting Sinwar. He had a lot of blood in his hands. American blood, Israeli blood, and others. And I told him that we were really pleased with his action. And further that, now's the time to move on. Move on, move toward a ceasefire in Gaza. Make sure that we move in the direction that we're going to be in a position to make things better for the whole world. It's time for this war to end and bring these hostages home.
Vice President Kamala Harris says justice has been served with Sinwar's killing.
And the United States, Israel, and the entire world are better off as a result. Sinwar was responsible for the killing of thousands of innocent people, including the victims of October 7 and hostages killed in Gaza. He had American blood on his hands. Today, I can only hope that the families of the victims of Hamas feel a sense and measure of relief.
Hamas leader Yahya Sinwar, a mastermind of the October 7 attack that triggered the Gaza war, killed by Israeli forces. There has been no immediate comment from Hamas, but sources in the militant group say indications suggest Sinwar had been killed in an Israeli operation. Sinwar was named the overall leader of Hamas following the assassination of political chief Ismail Haniyeh in Tehran in July. Netanyahu says Sinwar's death offers the chance for peace in the Middle East, but warns that the war in Gaza was not over.
Yahya Sinwar is dead. He was killed in Rafah by the brave soldiers of the Israel Defense Forces. While this is not the end of the war in Gaza, it's the beginning of the end. To the people of Gaza, I have a simple message. This war can end tomorrow. It can end if Hamas lays down its arms and returns our hostages.
The number of Filipinos who have returned from conflict-hit Lebanon climbs to over 500. The latest group of 47 repatriates arrived Thursday via Kuwait Airways flight. They are set to receive 170,000 pesos financial assistance from the government. Authorities say some Filipinos have chosen to stay in Lebanon for personal reasons despite the escalating conflict. The government vows to continue monitoring the situation and provide assistance, while plans for a mandatory evacuation are still under review.
We're waiting for the ambassador's recommendation. One, if there is no more functioning government locally. The other is if the situation is already such that there is total risk to life.
We're making our services more available. We have hotlines. We have transport even, no? Doon sa mga nangangailangan na maidala sa mga shelters. May mga roving teams tayo.
Now let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America. We begin with the latest on the U.S. presidential race. A critical battleground state, North Carolina, began early voting Thursday. On Tuesday, Georgia, another key swing state, opened its polls to early voting. And voters came in record numbers. As of Wednesday, the Office of Georgia's Secretary of State says more than 600,000 votes were recorded.
There's so many issues that are at stake for this 2024 election, and we are going to be affected if we, whoever you want to choose.
Filipino-American Ana Mercado Sanchez and her two daughters were among the hundreds of thousands who cast their votes Tuesday.
Our democracy is at stake. We need to make sure that people are aware of what issues there are for this election. You know, Supreme Court appointments, who we elect are going to appoint people in the Supreme Court that will affect our nation. We as a community, Filipino Americans, we will be affected.
In other news, a new exhibit that shines a spotlight on an often overlooked history of the Philippine-American War has opened its doors in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, in time for Filipino-American History Month this October. The Philippine-American War exhibit tells the story of a three-year brutal conflict between the U.S. and Filipino revolutionaries after the U.S. annexed the Philippines following the end of Spanish-American War.
The Philippine-American War that followed was a direct result of this denial of our nation's right to self-rule. This war, fought from 1899 to 1902, was not only a military conflict, but the struggle for the soul of a nation. The Filipinos fought bravely for their independence, but the consequences were devastating.
The Philippine-American War exhibit will run until December 2025 aboard the USS Olympia at the Independence Seaboard Museum in the City of Brotherly Love. And finally, in entertainment news, the aces of P-pop, BGYO, joined TikTok's Asian Pacific Islander resource group, Arise, for their Filipino-American History Month celebration.
After a month from the U.S., we came back again and to be here at TikTok Creator Studio and perform here at more shows coming up for this week for BGYO.
We're always motivated to do our best in everything.
This is the first ever TikTok live, TikTok stage event in North America. So, once in a lifetime opportunity to be the first. And we're thankful we're the artists here today. And we got to share music, especially during Filipino American History Month. So, it's such a good combo.
BGYO performed several of their hits, including Trash and Gigil, which have inspired TikTok challenges. For TikTok Arise's co-president Gino Lucas, he takes pride in sharing Filipino artists on the popular social networking site.
It's just nice to like bridge the gaps between Filipinos in the Philippines and Filipinos here in the States. So I'm just glad to, you know, have them here and like everyone be a part of this really special moment.
So everyone in the Creator Studio.
And those are the news making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the rundown.
Authorities ruling out third-party involvement in the death of 31-year-old former One Direction member Liam Payne. An initial autopsy revealed the singer sustained 25 injuries consistent with a fall, including fatal head trauma. While the case is being treated as a suspicious death as a protocol, prosecutors suggest Payne was alone at the time and may have been under the influence of substances. Police found narcotics, alcohol, and smashed furniture in the disordered hotel room where he was staying. Payne, who rose to global fame with a boy band One Direction, was found dead after falling from a third-floor hotel room balcony in Buenos Aires on Wednesday, sparking an outpouring of tributes from fans.